Hey, what's new? This is What's New, the show packed full of news and stories just for you from BBC Africa. Want to see more? Here we go. 10 years after the protests of the Arab Spring, young Tunisians are marching in the footsteps of their elders. What is it like living in the country most affected by COVID on the continent? We'll be speaking to young people in South Africa almost a year after the first case of coronavirus there.
I feel like we're just tired of the virus. We are tired, people are getting retrenched, people are losing family. So I feel like we are definitely devastated.
Dancing themselves to a better future. You'll meet the young people from Bariga beating the odds with theatre.
Dance has transformed my life, it has helped me change a lot of things. We might be from Bariga, a dirty, poor community, but we are ready to take over the world.
First, we'll look at what's been called the Arab Spring. Well, it's a series of events and protests that changed parts of the Middle East and North Africa. It all began 10 years ago with one man's radical act of protest. Many more people took to the streets, but did they get the revolution they were fighting for? Nyasha Michelle explains.
The Arab Spring, a series of events and protests that profoundly changed the Middle East and North Africa region. But how did it start? It all began in late 2010 in Tunisia when a fruit seller, Mohamed Bouazizi, set himself on fire after police took his cart and weighing scale for operating without a license. A radical form of protest which resulted in many people taken to the streets as a cry out against corruption, oppression, and unemployment in their country. Dozens were killed and injured, and this became known as the Jasmine Revolution. In an attempt to take back control, the then president Zine El Abidine Ben Ali declared a state of emergency and promised new elections within 6 months. But that didn't work. Many had lost hope in the president who had already been in power for 24 years. So armed officials and other politicians took power from him. As he was forced to flee his country to Saudi Arabia, the uprisings didn't stop there. The anger began to spread. Inspired by the Tunisian people's defiance, many in other countries took to the streets to protest against authoritarian governments in their own nations. Protests grew in other countries, including Syria, Morocco, Algeria, and Egypt, where President Hosni Mubarak, who had been in power for 30 years, was also forced out of office. These acts of defiance by the people is what became known as the Arab Spring. But what first started off as peaceful pro-democracy protests turned into civil wars in Libya, Syria, and Yemen, displacing and killing millions of people. Tunisia did, however, experience a more peaceful transition and held its first democratic parliamentary elections in 2011. But stability was short-lived. The country has had 12 different governments in the last 10 years, and most recently, more than 600 people were arrested for protesting for a change of regime. Many of them were teenagers. Now, 10 years after the Arab Spring began, some are wondering if the revolution they fought so hard for will ever come.
Thank you, Nyasha. As you've just heard, in Tunisia, young people are still not satisfied. But what are the current demonstrations about? Well, Andre has been speaking to some of them to find out why they're protesting.
The protests are mainly based around one thing, the economy.
For me, what happened in this protest is the right thing, because the government is robbing us. People became angry and went out so they can steal also.
The situation is very difficult in Tunisia, in particular on the social level, and even freedoms have become restricted.
Yes, a third of young people are unemployed and the situation isn't getting better. Tourism makes up a large part of the economy here, and due to the pandemic, visitors are few and far between. No tourists equals fewer jobs. The protests have spread across the country, from the capital Tunis to the cities of Kasserine, Gafsa, Sousse and Monastir. Many of the protesters are from working class neighbourhoods which have been particularly affected by the struggling economy. It's a very different scene to the quiet streets of the last few months. There's been a nighttime curfew since October due to COVID. So what do these protests hope to achieve?
The only thing we have is freedom of expression, and we have to preserve it.
I want to leave Tunisia. What am I doing here? My life here is bad. It's possible that there in Europe it's better. At least there I can do something. Here, I can't do anything.
The government has called in the army to help control the demonstrations. There have been looting of shops and buildings vandalised. One thing is for sure, the protests may die down, but the problems that led to them will be a lot harder to solve.
We go to Senegal now to meet our new reporter, Aisha. Senegal is currently experiencing a second wave of the coronavirus pandemic, more serious than the initial one. There have been more than 25,000 cases. It's much less than in the worst affected countries on the continent, such as South Africa or Morocco. But it's a setback for the country in its fight against the virus.
Hello, I'm Aisha and I'm in Dakar, the capital of Senegal. Not that long ago, in September, Senegal was being praised for its handling of COVID-19 pandemic. This success was due to the effectiveness of its response at the beginning of the epidemic. Among other measures, rapid tests, hospital treatment for all positive cases. If you were in contact with a positive case, you were ordered to quarantine in a hotel paid by the government, land and air borders were closed, and travel between cities were banned. After that, the country experienced a downward trend, and one could think that the fight against COVID-19 was already won. However, Senegal is now experiencing a second wave. From about 10 or less positive cases at the beginning of November, the daily average stands now at more than 200. So many restrictions have been reinstated. For example, a ban on gathering on beaches, sports fees and theatres, a limit on the number of passengers on public transports, the wearing of masks, it remains mandatory in all public and private places. You can't go out after 9 in the evening in Dakar and the nearby region of Thiès. However, schools remain open. The fact that they were closed at the beginning of the pandemic, when there were fewer than 100 positive cases, and that they are now open, is worrying some pupils. So far, authorities haven't said anything about the issue, but they continue to insist on measures like wearing masks, washing hands, and social distancing. And this time, to fight the virus, they also count on vaccination. I don't know if it has started in your country, but here, first doses are due to arrive next month.
Thanks, Aisha. And in the second part of this program, we'll go to South Africa to see how teenagers there cope with the pandemic. Now, giraffes. Long necks, long legs. In fact, most giraffes are as tall as three of your teachers standing on top of each other. Now, That I'd like to see. While they're up there on each other's shoulders wondering what is going on, here are three giraffe facts that might just impress them if they don't fall down fast. Fact one, giraffes have a big heart. It weighs about 11 kilos, and that's because it needs to pump blood all the way up to their head. Fact two, just like us, giraffes have 7 neck vertebrae, but theirs can be 25 centimeters long. Fact three, they drink water when they can, but don't need to drink on a daily basis. Well, actually, the giraffes you're going to see now had plenty of water. In fact, too much. They had to be rescued from floods by conservationists in eastern Kenya. A tall order. Here's Christine.
6 months ago, a group of skilled conservationists coordinated a daring and unusual rescue operation to save 8 Rothschild giraffes from Longicharo Island near Lake Baringo in western Kenya.
So what they did on this island was to make sure that they did some lines which were put up more or less using cardboards or canvas, which would lead the giraffe into a crate which was right at the edge of the water. But they were able to do that. Yeah, very delicate. It was not very, very easy to put the giraffe to sleep. You know, looking at the circumstances surrounding the giraffes, the water all around, and the giraffes once gutted, they would really run off. And at this point, they could have gone into the water. So they had to really blindfold the giraffe and lead it on this crate.
When the floods hit the western parts of Kenya last year, so many people lost their homes as their houses were submerged in water. But what we didn't think about is how wildlife in the area survived.
That means that their feeding range is reduced. So with that, then they get less food. And with less feed, then animals start to get stressed. So what happens to giraffes specifically when they start getting stressed? They will exemplify such signs such as the barking of trees. You find them now debarking all the trees that are within their vicinity. Again, when now they start debarking the trees, this affects the growth of these trees that reduces again further their forage.
The team used a specially adapted barge to float Asiwa, one of the giraffes, back to mainland. She had been stranded on a more remote part of the island, making her rescue a priority.
Giraffes are very, very heavy. A mature giraffe would weigh a female would weigh about 1,200 kilograms. A male can weigh all the way to 1,900 kilograms. Those are really, really many kilos floating on water.
The populations of giraffes in Africa has been on the steady decline due to habitat loss and poaching. One of the most threatened is the Rothschild giraffe. This is why the rescue operations are very important to the team of conservationists.
Great. Now, cases of coronavirus continue to rise in the worst affected countries in Africa. Although the reported death rate from the virus is lower on the continent than in many other parts of the world, there has been warning that the pandemic is far from over. In South Africa, where a new, more infectious strain of COVID-19 has been identified, the number of cases is close to hitting 1.5 million. This shows the situation right now. As you can see, the number of daily cases was higher in January than it was during the first peak in July. Although it does seem that the number of diagnosed people is on its way down again. In March, the government introduced one of the world's strictest lockdowns, including a ban on the sale of alcohol and people only allowed to leave their houses for essential reasons. Even now, borders remain closed and a curfew for everyone but essential workers is in place from 9 at night till 5 in the morning. So, what is it like to be young in the worst hit country for COVID on the continent? We spoke to 3 teenagers from across South Africa.
I feel like we're just tired of the virus. We are tired, people are getting retrenched, people are losing family. So I feel like we are definitely devastated.
Seeing how bad the economy is doing now that the alcohol ban has happened. But I do agree with it to a certain extent because people were being really reckless. When you see videos of people in clubs and all these places, no one was wearing a mask.
Yes, I am definitely worried about my future as to whether I'm going to get a job or I'll even be able to study further. And because I've got so many dreams and aspirations.
I'm Rejoice and I'm from Limpopo, South Africa.
I'm Sissy Po and I am from Johannesburg, South Africa.
I am Kanya and I am from the Eastern Cape, South Africa.
During the first wave, South Africa had one of the world's strictest lockdowns. Do you think this was necessary?
The strict lockdown, strict restrictions were very necessary because in that time we were preparing for, you know, the upcoming pandemic. And yeah, so I feel like it was definitely necessary.
I don't think it was necessary, the strict ones. I just think people should abide to the rules, whether people are at home or not. People should just wear their masks. They should get home, wash when they come from the store or anything like that. Because regardless of whether we keep getting locked down, the virus will spread. Whereas now when it's the second wave, there's everyone getting the virus just going to the store. But if you abide, maybe I just think that the whole concept we should master is abiding to what they say we should do.
If you look at the alcohol ban, for example, it's affecting the economy so much. Because alcohol is one of the biggest contributors to our economy. So I don't think a stricter lockdown is necessary.
Why do you think South Africa has had more virus cases than anywhere else in Africa?
In other African countries, we didn't see people go to clubs, we didn't see people going out, having fun, living their lives. When I saw people making TikToks and all those things, they were home. We made TikToks in clubs and all those sort of stuff.
If you look at it from a different point of view, if you look at some of these African countries, they're not as well developed as South Africa. And then but if you also look at the equipment in terms of getting the testing kits to all these countries and everyone in those countries being able to afford to get a test.
I 100% agree with Sisipo. I think it's because we are not adhering to the rules. I'm not too sure about other countries, but I know that definitely in South Africa, a lot of people don't adhere to the restrictions. Things like simple things like wearing a mask, sanitizing.
What have you found difficult? And what have you done to cope?
Usually people are excited. People are posting about Christmas. Everyone is looking forward to Christmas, but that for the first time, that wasn't there last year. Like that was, everyone was just so tired, we're devastated, we're worn out. So I feel like we just tired of the virus.
So what I've done to cope during this time was just to use these online platforms to communicate with my friends and my family, obviously because we couldn't travel, we couldn't have normal contact meetups.
But one thing about it is that everyone had to do something about their feelings, emotions, and everything in terms of their mental health.
And thank you, Joyce, Sisipo, and Kanya for speaking to What's New. We all love to dance, don't we? Well, I do. Let's find out how some kids are dancing themselves to a better future. Over to you, Dami.
Dance is not just about body movement, but it's also an art of expression. This is a disadvantaged community close to the Lagoon in Lagos, where some children are using dance and theater to harness their talent and as a way to beat social vices and gain hope for the future.
Welcome to Bariga, the most beautiful and richest community in Lagos State, Nigeria. This is where I live with many other children like me. I am Moses and I am 15 years old, but I have traveled to more than 10 countries in Europe.
I see this girl from Germany, she'll be first person. Take bus, make it come to Kimberley.
Surprise! Let me show you how that was possible. Come. For children like me in this area, this place has become our home. It is called the Seaside Cottage Theatre. I used to be a stubborn boy. Then before I joined the theater group, I was a fighter, I was a gambler, I do a lot of things that are bad. And you know, in my street, they know me as Moses number one, don't try him. In the sense that they will even take me to a different street to go and be beating people that are older than me. And
And now for dance, dance has transformed my life. It has helped me change a lot of things. My parents never wanted me to be a dancer because they think dancers are people who doesn't have future, who doesn't have anything to do in life. And for me, I think dance for me is just dance is a world on its own, and a world where you see many creative mindsets. I joined the footprint of David Arts Academy 2014 when I was 8 years old. Dance has taken me to a lot of places in Europe. I've been to France, I've been to Germany, I've been to Switzerland, I've been to Dubai, I've been to Turkey. I've performed for the President of France, Emmanuel Macron, and President of Germany, Gretchen Gwak, when he came to Nigeria, and different countries. The thing I love the most in the countries I've been to is their environment, their manner of approach, and the love they generate, their vibes, just everything, except their food, because their food is somehow. It's not like when I'm eating Eba and Egusi. Since I've joined the footprint of David, I've been able to get myself in a better position. I've been able to think smart. I've been able to be bold. I've been able to be strong. I've been able to be smart.
Our first trip to Europe started after our experience at one international dance theater competition. Yeah, so we were privileged to win, and we won the award of the best student theater in Africa. Then a friend from Germany, from a theater company, reached out to us for a collaboration, and boom, that's how the tour started. So I started Footprints of David Arts Academy in 2005 to actually use art, dance especially, as a tool to, you know, revive the kids in my community, you know. Something to distract them away from the social vices, you know, and my own experience also growing up as a child. I was raised by my foster parents, and my experience wasn't that, you know, palatable. So I decided to use this approach to prevent those kids not to go that route, you know, and that's why Footprint is using art as a tool for community development.
Right from when I was a kid, I loved dancing, and that's what I'm doing right now. In the future, I want to become a dance philanthropist. We, the children of Seaside Cottage Theatre, we've been able to succeed in our academics here in Lagos State, Nigeria, and in Africa as a whole. We might be from Bariga, a dirty, poor community, but we are ready to take over the world.
Yes, that's all from us for now, but there's a way to see all of this again and lots of other great stories about what you all get up to on our YouTube channel. Just go to youtube.com/BBC What's New. Give it a go and don't forget to hit the subscribe button so you get all the latest updates, and also makes me happy when you do. So see you soon. Bye.